Welcome to the Sustainable Living Podcast, tips, tools, and tactics for living a heart-centered life that honors Mother Earth and her inhabitants. The information shared on the Sustainable Living Podcast reflects the opinions of host Marian West, Janice Fryant, and their guests. Please use your own discretion and research before applying any information to your individual situation. Now, here are your hosts, Marian and Janice.
Welcome to the podcast, everyone. Today, I'm delighted to welcome back Linda Borghi of Farm A Yard, who is going to share a little bit more of her expertise on such things as the soil, growing your own food, and how this all might transform our world. Welcome, Linda.
Thank you so much for having me on again, Janice. I'm so excited to be here.
Yeah, well, you gave us so much to think about last time, and I certainly wanted to follow up and see what you're doing now, and also kind of take off on our conversation last time and build on that, maybe talking a little bit more about the basics of growing food, which comes down to the soil and how important that is for us. It's something that we take for granted. We alternately call it dirt, and there's so many names for it. But in general, we really don't generally understand how important it is to our lives and how important it is to, the health of the soil is important to the survival of all of life on the planet. So let's get into that a little bit. Tell me what you know about dirt.
Well, you know, it's very interesting that you say dirt, because whenever anyone refers to the soil as dirt, I always have to correct them and remind them that dirt is something you sweep off of your kitchen floor, and you won't get much of a crop from that.
Mm-hmm.
soil is something that we really have been very disconnected from. That's what I see, anyway, as a grandmother, as a mother, as a human being. We're very disconnected from that as an entity. I mean, we're just not aware of it as the earth beneath our feet. And yet, I find it ironic that without it, right, that 6-inch layer of topsoil, right, We cannot exist. I mean, we can't exist until we no longer require to consume food, right?
Mm-hmm.
it's something that's vital to our existence, 100% vital to our existence. And, you know, our soil really has to be looked at as the major asset of any nation.
Yes.
Because if you don't have soil as an asset, right, How can you feed your citizens?
Right.
I mean, you know.
Exactly.
It's really gotten down to that.
Yeah. I was just going to say, most people, we all tend to think that it's there, right? It's covering the earth. It's going to be there forever. We can't,
right.
How can we possibly hurt it? How can we possibly do anything that's going to harm it and affect its ability to produce our food?
Well, it is in fact producing food. But the majority of it is producing food for animal protein. It's not really producing food for us.
Mm-hmm.
And the food that it's producing for us, it's really not high on the Richter scale when it comes to nutritive value. Nutritive. I mean, we need to eat nutrient-dense food because our bodies are a very complex, complicated machine.
Mm-hmm.
And when we are only putting 7 elements, right, as in commercial fertilizers, only 7 elements. I mean, I'm not very good at science, but I know there's more than 7 elements.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to give that soil what it needs In order to give us what we need. It's really a closed loop.
Well, tell me something here. I'm under the impression that our traditional industrial farming methods have done a lot, actually, to harm our soil and to make it less nutrient dense. Is that correct?
Well, what happened after World War II? you know, we built all these factories, right, to make bombs,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
Now there was no war. You know, what were we going to do with those factories? We were going to turn around and turn it into fertilizer. So now from that point, we have gotten on a, we're like a derailed train.
Mm-hmm.
We now are shooting the gene of an herbicide called Roundup, shooting it actually with a gun, right,
mm-hmm.
into the DNA of the seed. And I'm going to tell you, folks, it's not a precise process. All you have to do is Google it. Now, why are we doing that? Why are we shooting this gene of this pesticide into the gene of the seed? We're doing it so that we go, we plant all the corn, we plant all the soy, and the list goes on and on and on.
Mm-hmm.
We spray that entire field with Roundup. Everything dies but what we're supposed to eat.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I don't know about anyone that's listening to this currently, but I can't see how we could grow something to support life from death. Right?
Right. And you make a really good point about just the chemicals that we're throwing in there. But even our traditional methods, you know, we till, we put chemical fertilizers in, we put the seeds in, and then we take it out. And over time, we kind of deplete the soil. Isn't that right?
That's correct. But really, the real crux of the matter, it's kind of like, you know, if you get a disease, you know, we don't look to see how we got the disease. We just treat the disease, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So now we have depleted soil. But the crux of the matter is we're not really paying attention to soil at all, mm-hmm. as an entity.
Yes.
Like you said, it's just there. I mean, how many people walk around and say, oh, isn't it so lovely to have all this air?
Yeah.
We don't say that.
No.
Because it's just there. The same thing with the soil. What we need to do is to re-educate people that soil is a living organism. It is an organism that feeds us. So how we take care of the soil is going to a result in how we are taken care of, how we are fed,
yes.
from that property. And, you know, Farmyard, it's a movement, have you heard?
Yes.
If everyone grew, took responsibility to grow some of their food, right?
Mm-hmm.
And but no matter what you do, you still have to acknowledge and pay attention and know what to do,
mm-hmm.
with the soil.
Well, let me stop you for a second, because you mentioned a term. You said that the soil is a living organism. So could you explain what you mean by that?
I can, but I can't do it in a very scientific way.
That's okay.
Because I've been farming for a long time, you know, and I have an intimate relationship with compost.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean intimate.
Okay.
And through the art of observation, if you look at humus, rich, beautiful, you know, topsoil, rich, beautiful medium that has been cared for and loved, right? It is a lot of activity going on.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of stuff happening, and that's just my eye.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you take it down a notch, right,
mm-hmm.
you've got all these beautiful microbes.
Mm-hmm.
And then take it down another notch. So it's a very complex system. So what we need to do for this Earth, to honor it, is give it everything that nature has in store, you know, everything that nature has in store.
Well,
and that's what I do as a biodynamic farmer using bioenergetic methods.
Well, it sounds like what you're talking about is a tiny microscopic community there. And what you're doing is to nurture that community, help to make that community healthy so that it can continue producing the things that help to grow our more nutrient-dense food, correct?
Most definitely. And, you know, I want all of their bellies full, being an Italian grandmother. That's very important. That's very important to me. And, you know, in the launching of Farmyard, I moved myself from the Hudson Valley in New York, where I was farming for 10 years. Mm-hmm. I moved myself to Beaufort, South Carolina, so that I could focus on, you know, getting the word out for the mission and the movement of Farmyard. Mm-hmm. But the soil is completely different now up in the Hudson Valley. It was clay, it was rock, completely different. Down here, it was nothing. It is nothing but sand. And I mean sand, sand, sand. Now, if I was an uneducated farmer in the bioenergetic methods, right, I would say, oh, my God, I'm not going to be able to grow anything here without, you know, bringing in topsoil, bringing in soil. But, no, what was the first thing that I did? And this is something that everyone listening here can do. The very first thing that I did was I made myself a worm bin. Mm. Of red wigglers. I got my worms from the worm ladies in Cranston, Rhode Island. They came in the mail, my 1,000 red wigglers. And I started my red wiggler community and my worms. And I haven't had a worm bin. I hadn't had a need for a worm bin. It exploded. It exploded so much that I was able to carve out an area for a compost pile and then smear along the bottom of that area with the red wigglers and organic material and then dry oak leaves. And now I'm collecting coffee grounds from the local coffee shop and I'll build myself a beautiful pile and then I will inoculate it with the biodynamic preparations. And in 2 months, I'll have wonderful topsoil.
Wow.
Something that everyone can do. I mean, 30-gallon Rubbermaid containers.
Yeah.
Go on YouTube.
Well, I'll share with you my experience with that because I did have my own worm bin last year. And the reason I got it was because I did try some fresh worm castings from, you know, there's a local worm farmer here in Big Bear, and I met him at a garden workshop, and he was selling these big bags of worm castings. I brought them home, and I put them on my plants, around my plants. It was like, it was like Popeye eating spinach. Okay, I mean, immediately, within hours of watering that stuff in, you could see the plants just, they just had this renewed love for life or something. They were just reaching up so strong and vibrant. You could really physically see it. So I was convinced, and I got my, I ordered my my worms, and they came in the mail, and I started my bin, and for a while it was working great, but then after a while I did something wrong with it. Within a few months, I had done something wrong with it, and it wasn't, they weren't producing anymore, and I think they were dying. I wasn't seeing them around there, you know, even when I dug in there. So, but what you just described about making this thing outside and inoculating it with, you know, more microbes and all, that sounds like maybe a better deal or an easier thing to do. Am I wrong?
Well, it's a trial for me. And what I did, I have 13 Farmyard beds. A Farmyard bed is 2 feet wide, and these are short beds. They're 10 feet long. And if I was growing, let's say, leaf lettuce, I would have 5 rows of leaf lettuce on that 2-foot bed. So instead of having 5 rows, I dug a furrow down the center, and I planted the worms. And I added material, and I covered them up, and I made the other four, you know, I planted 4 rows. Right now I'm putting in short dwarf gray pea shoots for the nitrogen, to fix the nitrogen.
Uh-huh.
And not only that, they're so yummy. I mean, I love going out there just eating those pea shoots. They're outside. I mean, they're so delicious. And for me, coming from the Northeast, you know, being outside in January to begin with is just a novelty. And now being able to plant is even more interesting this time of year. So, yeah, anybody can really, you know, but I think it's a matter of trial and error, right?
Mm-hmm.
You tried it. They didn't produce, but maybe going back to that worm guy and getting some more information on how, because it's such a great way for others, whoever's listening here, for capturing the waste stream of coffee grounds.
Mm-hmm.
They love coffee grounds. So, I mean, God knows we're out there buying coffee all the time. So if you have a local coffee shop, if you get yourself 2 5-gallon pails with lids, ask your coffee shop if they would collect it in there, and you have to be responsible and go back, you know, frequently, but you would go, drop off the empty pail and take the full one. And what is that going to do for you? Worm castings outside of bat guano. There's nothing more powerful.
Yeah, I've seen it. I can attest to that.
They are poopers. They are just poopers.
Yeah.
And I got to tell you, I think the intent is also very important. Because every time I open that worm bin, I say, here it comes, kiddos. Bottom up.
Well, yeah. And then that poop is what feeds the beautiful soil community that we were talking about. They just love that food. It does so much for your soil. So, you know, getting back to this idea that how important the soil is, I mean, in my permaculture course with Larry Santoyo that I took a couple of years ago, was it a year ago? I don't know. I remembered this quote. He said, we are not gardeners, we are soil managers. That's our business. Is we're in the business of soil management if we're trying to grow food.
Yes.
And that's a bit that when you place the focus on the soil, it's a whole different thing, isn't it?
It is a whole different thing. And then also what it's going to do, it's going to open up areas of interest in the individual, you know, because through a connection, look, it's the land in which we live.
Mm-hmm.
It supports our being.
Mm.
And getting an intimate relationship with that entity. I mean, this is the earth.
Yes. And you know, on that note, I think it was a few months ago, I read an article about how getting your hands in the soil, just actually being physically in contact with the soil, has been proven to fight depression. We become more optimistic when we actually have our hands in the dirt.
Well, you know, it's interesting because 2 years ago I was T-boned in my Subaru, and the car rolled 3 times, and I was gifted with 4 herniated discs in my neck.
Oh boy.
What did I do? Well, they wanted to operate on it, and if I had another neck, I would have considered it, but I passed on that option, and I studied it. And there is a process called earthing. It's spelled just the way it says. And it's an individual from Alaska that encountered it or discovered it or whatever you want to say he did. But what it is when what happened was, we put rubber on the bottom of our shoes. And when we put rubber on the bottom of our shoes, that blocked the ions that were coming off of the Earth's surface. So I got a pad for my mattress that was plugged into the Earth, an earthing mattress, right, pad. And I was able to get earthing shoes, clogs, that actually have, at the pressure points, copper going from the earth, from the bottom through to the toe. So it doesn't block it, because I don't wear shoes. I didn't wear shoes farming, and I always felt wonderful, but I suffered from it in the winter. And in discovering earthing, it really benefited me so much. So therefore, yes, putting our hands in the earth, putting our feet in the earth, we get that vibration, and now science is catching up with the rest of that. You know, now it's known that it's the ionization. That's what we're lacking since we put rubber on the bottom of our shoes.
And so did that have a big effect on your healing process?
Very big effect. It was incredible the amount of inflammation was removed.
Wow.
If you Google it, there's a documentary, and the whole town had these mats for their bed, you know. And one lady returned it because she was on disability and she couldn't afford to feel too good.
Whoa, that's quite an interesting reason.
I tell you, I just found it. It was very comical, very, very comical.
Oh, that's hilarious. That kind of reminds me of that headline, my USA Today headline that I keep referring to from the 90s that I saw that was happiness is bad for the economy. Do you want to have money or do you want to be happy?
Well, it's interesting. I really honestly feel we're going into the light and it's not the headlights of the oncoming train.
Yes, me too.
Don't you?
Absolutely. It's so exciting.
Oh, my God. Some days I feel like I'm going to levitate and just lift right off the ground.
Me too.
Honest to God, I'll tell you something that has thrilled me beyond belief. And this is a big portion of why I feel so very elated going into this brand new clean slate of a year. Mm-hmm. And that is because my background in farming is in biodynamics. Mm-hmm. I was taught by Günter Hauck, who was, I was interning. I was the very first intern at the Pfeiffer Center Garden in Chestnut Ridge, New York. Mm-hmm. And that is where biodynamics arrived into the United States in the early 50s.
Mm-hmm.
So now, I've been at it a long time. I've been at it a very long time.
You've been actually practicing biodynamic farming since the 50s?
No, that's when biodynamics came into the country.
Okay, so when did you start doing it?
I started doing it when my son was 10, and he's 31. So 21 years
wow.
ago.
Wow, that's a long
so
time.
It's a while ago. Very long time. But, the biodynamic preparations and the processes can be very difficult for, most individuals to comprehend. I know it didn't latch on to me really quickly.
Well, before we get into that, could you maybe explain briefly what the idea behind biodynamic farming is? We did talk about it, I think, in the last our last chat, but could you kind of summarize it again?
I can summarize it. Biodynamics are the principles of Dr. Rudolf Steiner. Mm-hmm. And Dr. Steiner brought the world Waldorf education, eurythmy, and anthroposophy. Mm-hmm. And in 1924, a group of Austrian farmers asked a question of Steiner, and it was the reason why they asked the question was because they already saw the nutritive value of the food they were growing diminishing, mm-hmm. and the germination of their seed. So the question was, Dr. Steiner, what of agriculture? And out of that question...
Wait, what was the question? Could you repeat that question again?
Yes, the question was, what about agriculture?
Oh, right, okay.
Because he had given philosophy in education, mm-hmm. and dance and theology,
Yeah, he was so quite the thinker.
Yes, he was. He was quite the singer. I believe he was at the same time as Edgar Casey in the States, but I'm not 100% sure of that. But anyway, so that's what they asked him. What of agriculture? And out of that came 12 lectures, and that is what we call the agriculture course.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, it was very, and still is, very complicated and not easy principles for me to grasp.
Mm-hmm.
But he was such a wonderful thinker that he gave recipes, and those are the biodynamic preparations.
Well, and from my understanding, mm-hmm. I get that it's very based a lot more on the idea of energy.
Well, what Steiner did was he proved esoteric practices via science. He was extremely scientific,
mm-hmm.
but yet he wasn't working in that realm.
Okay.
He was definitely working in the realm of energy,
mm-hmm.
100%. So as a biogenetic farmer, spraying these preparations draw that energy to that activity. That's what it does.
And those are the recipes, the preparations are the recipes you're referring to, correct?
Yes, they are. The preparations are the recipe. So, here's the recipe. Stir this in. Stir this in a 5-gallon vessel for an hour, and then apply it this way, and you do it for this, and you do it for that. And I did that for, the majority of the length of the 21 years, let's say 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
Then last year, I was introduced to a young man by the name of Evan Fold out of Wilmington, North Carolina.
Mm-hmm.
And what Evan Fold had done was he had packaged the biodynamic preparations in what he called the bioenergetic method.
Mm-hmm.
And I have to tell you, step two after the worm bin. And compost in a box.
Uh-huh.
The directions and apply them. Now, the average person does not have to learn all of the things that I had to learn over the past 20 years. And thank God, because we're kind of on a little bit of a short track, it is my sinister plan to spray the country. Entire country. And why would I want to do that? Why? Why?
Uh-huh.
What benefit would I get out of having this entire country spray?
Uh-huh.
The benefit is the energy will shift.
Yeah.
Because that's what it does. And I truly believe in my heart of hearts, we are looking to the wrong place. We're looking for the material, the physical to shift. We have to look for the energy to shift. Because when that energy shifts, everything shifts at the same time.
Oh, I completely agree. I completely agree with that. Yes, that makes a lot of sense. Now, I interviewed Evan on a previous podcast. It was really interesting, very interesting what he had to say. I find this whole thing of bioenergetic, biodynamic farming fascinating. I mean, from the standpoint of someone who, I teach yoga, I meditate every day. I mean, I really, really look at energy, as the source, of all that we see around us. And so to apply, ideas that are based on energy into my gardening really kind of excites me. So I'm really looking forward to what you guys are going to be teaching through Farm A Yard. And so maybe you could share, you mentioned a little bit about the compost in a box. Could you tell us about that?
Sure. Compost in a box is the creation of Evan Fold, and his website is micromakers.com.
Mm-hmm.
Just click on the growing products, and there's the page of compost in a box. And it's a whole bunch of selections. What you're really selecting is how many gallons you want
mm-hmm.
to produce. And everything that is in that box, once you apply it, you have now applied the biodynamic preparation.
Mm.
2 teaspoons of this, 2 teaspoons of that. But it's not just the biodynamic preparations. Earth, tonic is, you have to go onto the website. I am not a scientific person, but I'll tell you, I'm going to stir this afternoon. I'll be stirring. And if anyone would like to follow me on Facebook, it's Linda Borghi, Borghi. And I do put up stirring videos because anytime I stir, I get really excited. And when you go to micromakers.com, if you choose to purchase any of the box selections, you could put Lettuce Lady in for the discount code, and they'll give you 10%.
Oh, that's
what they call me. Yeah, that's what they call me in Walker Valley, the Lettuce Lady.
So. Okay, so if I go to micromakers.com and I want to get one of those compost in a box kits, there's a promo code thing, and I would put Lettuce Lady in that.
Yeah, and you'll get 10% off.
Awesome.
As a gift from me.
Okay. Thank you.
Fun, right? Yeah, you're welcome.
I have to say, that is really attractive to me because I have not had the greatest luck with composting here where I live. We have very little brown kind of waste here. I have, you know, I've got coffee grounds and eggshells all over the place, all kinds of, you know, kitchen scraps and stuff. But when it comes to dead leaves or anything like that, it's really kind of a desert here. So I've had a hard time getting any kind of real good compost going. So I definitely want to check that out.
Well, I really, truly believe that compost is an art. It really is an art form.
Mm-hmm.
And generally, an average household, let's hope, would not have enough material to actually build a pile, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Because really what you want to do, biodynamically speaking, when you're building a pile, you gather all of your material. So you have a pile of this and a pile of that and a pile of that, and then you make your cake. Then you make your pile. And then you cover it. Then you inoculate it. So I think it's really, and compost that is not made correctly will really hurt your garden more than it will help it.
Oh, yeah. I think I've experienced that.
Yeah. And also, such a big benefit of using the compost in the box, biodynamic preparations, is that in Egypt, it has reduced the use of water by 50% on the cotton.
Oh, wow. That's a big deal for me because I live in Southern California and we've had this ridiculous drought going for years.
10 years you've been in that drought on and off.
Mm-hmm.
So 50%. And even if you weren't in a drought, I mean, it is not, it's a limited resource.
Mm-hmm.
Water. It's not unlimited. So no matter what, we should always want to reduce our water consumption. And the crops yield increase by 30%.
Wow.
And this is all documented. The website you can go to is SECEM, S as in Sam, E, K, E, M as in Mary, SECEM Egypt. And that initiative started in 1977. And as we're speaking today, right now, Janice, they are converting sand to humus at a rate of twice the size of Central Park every year.
Whoa!
That is the Egyptian desert.
Wow.
So you don't have to know how things work in order for them to work. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And I, you know, the Evans compost in a box is very affordable.
Mm-hmm. How much is it?
You know, $50 for, and it makes 25 gallons.
Wow. Yeah, that sounds great.
So that's how, now, it wasn't until I met Evan that I knew that now we could do it. We can spray the country.
Mm-hmm.
What do people have to invest? $50?
Yeah, that's nothing.
Right?
Well, and
so excited.
Exactly. And now we're geeking out on soil here. Because
we are geeking out.
We love this stuff, but maybe not everybody is quite as into soil as we are. Let's talk a little bit about what happens when we have this wonderful soil and what we can do with it and why, you know, growing our own food is such a revolutionary, beneficial act, not just for ourselves, but for the entire planet.
Well, you know, speaking about the soil, you know, we were geeking out on soil, but even if you're not growing any food, and you have lawn, right?
Mm-hmm.
You should be spraying it as well because you want to still bless the earth beneath your feet.
Ah.
Period. Because it's still an asset.
Mm-hmm.
You know, whether it has, no matter what it has on it, it's an asset, and we have to honor it and treat it in that manner. But why is growing your food a revolutionary act? That is such a wild, great question. And the reason why it's wild is because we already did this. We did this during World War II. During World War II, 40% of all the food consumed in the United States came from your yard and my yard and their yard. We did it already, all of us. But what has happened, I believe, is we have lost the incentive to teach those specific skills. We have shifted our vision to teach our children other skills. And whether they be for the right or for the wrong, like when my grandmother's, what my grandmother used to say, if you boil it all down to a simple syrup, we all need to have the knowledge of how to sustain ourselves.
Okay, but why do we have to have that knowledge? I mean, I can just go down to the grocery store and buy all the food that I need. Doesn't that help the economy?
Well, you could buy all the food that you need, but it's not all the food that your body needs in the quality that your body needs. Let's say you go down to the supermarket and you happen to pick up some garlic, right? And it's garlic that doesn't have any roots on it. Well, that garlic came from China, and it was bleached. So we don't know. Walking through a stupid market, I'm sorry, that's what I call it, is like Russian roulette. Just take a look at where the fish is coming from. Thailand, far, far away. That is not sustainable.
Yeah.
And it's really riddled with disease.
Yeah.
Now let's compare the opposite side of that coin, right? You go outside, you throw some lettuce seeds in the ground, right? And 30 days later, you go out with a knife and you start to eat. Now, that lettuce is going to really feed you as compared to, because why is it going to feed you? Because it has a life force that was just cut from the mother. The mother's energy is still in that leaf, which lettuce is 85% water. Now, let's compare the supermarket to that. The lettuce is grown in California. It's harvested. It's washed. It's bagged. It's trucked over 3,000 miles to go to a distribution center, to go to the supermarket, to get in their produce aisle, to get in your car, to get in your refrigerator, to finally wind up on your plate. How much life force do you think that lettuce has with 85% water? It has none. So it's not feeding the person.
Well, and you haven't even mentioned all the poisons it probably has.
Oh, you know, it's just, I tell you, it has we're really consuming food mindlessly.
Yeah.
You know, we're very distracted and we're consuming food mindlessly. And, and we just have to wake up out of the slumber
and
realize that we have to get reconnected to this. My motto is, we have to eat the food where it's growing, and we have to grow the food where we are.
Yeah, well, that makes a lot of sense. But also from the standpoint of self-reliance. I mean, let's just imagine that something happens and the grocery store is closed, or the suppliers of the grocery stores can't get to them. There's so many scenarios that could actually result in this. And where are we then? We're completely vulnerable on these stores for our sustenance. Whereas if we're growing our own food, we've got a big level of self-reliance that we can achieve when we grow our own food.
Most definitely. And we need to teach people the skills to do that so that it could start up again, because really it's starting up. You know, when I started this gig, what I call my gig, there were 40 million acres of lawn in the United States. Now, fast forward, there's 48 million lawns in the United States. I've had enough. I have personally had enough. Really, I've had enough. The largest cultivated crop in the country, let's get a whiff of that. Let's get off of that gravy train.
Yeah.
Really, It's stupid.
Yeah, yeah, it is. And again, I mean, I, you know, it works very well if your main purpose is to, say, grow an economy that's based on, you know, rampant consumerism, you know.
Right.
Great for the economy, but great for people, not so much.
Well, you know, growing your own food is great for the economy, at least for your economy.
Exactly.
At FarmYard, we are carving out a webinar series that will teach you how to generate $75,000 on a half an acre of land in a season, 22 weeks. And now, I'm sure that sounds like an infomercial, but it's real. Mm-hmm. And like the sand turning into topsoil in Egypt, that's happening as we speak right now as well.
Mm-hmm. Well, maybe you could share a little bit about your future plans again with FarmYard. I think we talked a bit about that in our last discussion, but could you refresh everybody's memory a little bit on what you're doing there to teach people how to grow food that's going to actually earn them a living?
Most definitely. FarmYard's mission is to convert 48 million acres of lawn into food production areas while spraying the country. That's the mission. Mm-hmm. Now, how do we intend to do that? We intend to do that through webinar series that will teach you how to either grow food for yourself and your family, matching it to your family's likes and volume of consumption, so we're not throwing 50% of it in the garbage like we currently are doing today. Mm-hmm. 50% of all food today is goes to the landfill. And, or we will teach you how to grow food and earn money. Now, students are really where my heart aches, and that's really my focus. And my focus are students that are graduating from universities with an average of $37,000 in student loan debt. 75% of them will not find jobs in their field, but yet in 2 months, they have to start to make those payments. So I really want to show them how to wipe that debt out in 22 weeks. So that's what FarmYard, and it's all via a webinar series. Now, our target for our very first webinar is the end of February, and that webinar is going to be Evan Folds and all on soil fertility, because that is the first step.
Mm-hmm.
The first step is learning about getting accustomed to soil. It's just like when you meet somebody for the first time, you know? You have to get acquainted with one another. Mm-hmm. That's what Evan is going to teach. And that will begin, that will be the end of February. And we're going to give a free webinar in the middle of February to give an introduction to everybody as to what they will learn during this course. It'll be a series of four webinars, Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday. Mm-hmm. They will each be an hour and a half in length. And you'll also get an invitation to join a private Facebook group where you'll be able to submit questions. And the following day, once a week, every week, I'll come on Facebook Live and answer as many of those questions I can do within an hour. So it's exciting. Mm-hmm. Very lovely forward motion. It's education, education, education. It's through that. I teach you, you teach, and they teach, you know.
Yep.
It's the way we could have the ripple in the pond. You throw the pebble in, and then it ripples out. Because I know we can do this.
Mm-hmm. I do, too. I do, too. I have a lot of optimism about the future. And speaking of that, let's talk a little bit about the world that is to come when more and more of us are growing our own food and are applying these practices. Could you kind of paint a picture for us, Linda?
Oh, I can. I can, because I've had it in my lifetime. Mm-hmm. And because I've had it in my lifetime, I hold this thought in my mind all the time. So now I'm driving down the street, and I'm going down and make a right-hand turn, and where am I? I'm on Lettuce Lane. Everybody's front areas are growing different color lettuce, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And people are outside and they're talking to one another and they are interconnected. You know, there was a study that was done in Newark, New Jersey, and it was a doctor from India that was doing a graduate program, and he started growing food in the inner city of Newark, New Jersey. In the first year of that three-year study, 800 tons of food came out of Newark, New Jersey, and it drove all the drug dealers out. It did. Why? Because people were outside at night. They were talking to one another. Who was bringing a zucchini to this one, or who had that? It's about collaboration. It's about supporting each other. It's about being intensely focused on what really matters and not allowing ourselves to be distracted by the Broadway play that's happening constantly around us.
Mm-hmm.
We need to zoom in, pull back, zoom in on where we came from, what we need, and decide how we're going to move forward. You know, in a very sacred commerce, or for me, a very high-level thinking society, right?
Mm-hmm.
Let's say potatoes, right, are rare, and they're about to become extinct. Well, a certain group would not take those potatoes and hoard them. Now, in a collaborative society, everyone would decide what we were going to do next, where we would go next, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of Steiner's teaching has given me deep insight into that area. Steiner speaks of a threefold social order. And for me, it's just, you know, contentment and people really supporting each other and being able to disagree and being able to come to collaboration in areas. But it's all for the good of the organism.
Mm-hmm.
You see, it all goes back to organism. On a biodynamic farm, it's a self-contained organism. Everything comes from within. And that's what we need to do. We need to form those kind of pods. And I feel that just podcasts like yours, Janice, that's exactly what's happening. And it's so wonderful to have that connection.
Yes, yes, yes. From the micro community within our soil to the macro community that's all around us, it's just diversity is important, respect is important, and that interconnectedness, interaction is so important. And I am really looking forward to that day when we do have that kind of a life where we are interacting with our neighbors, where we are supporting all of each other's endeavors and our health and all the projects that we want to achieve with our communities. There's so much. And really, it can all begin with gardening in our yards.
It can. It is. You know, farming your yard is really a revolutionary act because you are becoming self-sufficient in a portion of your consumption needs. And that is not the plan.
Right. 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 Revolution. This is revolution. Absolutely. And it's about time for sure.
Absolutely. And you know, I just want to make this a very strong point. This next principle I want to present,
mm-hmm.
and that is all about intention. If each and every one of us intended for that to be the life we have now, the more people we have on board with those thought forms, the quicker it's going to manifest.
Mm-hmm.
It's the 100th monkey. It's the 100th monkey. It all, if you Google that, as my son told me, just Google it. Oh, God, I finally got it. Now I don't ask him anything anymore. I just Google it. But if you Google the 100th monkey experiment,
mm-hmm.
you'll see that once we get a percentage of individuals thinking the same thought, it all switches everywhere at the same time. How does it do that? I don't know, but I don't know about air. I don't know about
Exactly. You don't have to convince us here at the Sustainable Living Podcast, because that's really what our podcast is all about, helping people to envision that better world that, as Charles Eisenstein says, our hearts know is possible. And again, it's so important for more and more of us to paint that picture, just as you did a few minutes ago, Linda, because when people have those pictures in their minds, then as you said, it's leading towards more and more people having that consciousness shift, like the 100th monkey. The more that more of us that can envision a better world, the closer that better world comes to us.
And we want to envision it with a level of excitement, of a rocket ship.
Yes.
You know, just thrilled out of your mind that it's coming, it's here, it's almost arrived, you know?
Yep.
Because that is what sets it into action.
Yep.
It sets it into action. All those jujus go somewhere. They figure it all out.
Right.
And bingo, there we are.
Right, right. So, I mean, it's one thing to just describe it as this wonderful utopia that one day we might have, and another thing to actually put ourselves there right now in our imaginations and feel how it feels to live in that kind of a community. When you do that and you experience that emotion, that excitement, it really does kind of turbocharge it. I've had this experience many times with envisioning things I want to happen. So, yeah, you described it perfectly.
And not only do you want to feel how it happens, but as a farmer, I want you to taste how it happens, too.
Mm-hmm.
You're not just driving down Zucchini Boulevard, Lettuce Lane. Everywhere that you went, you would see vegetables growing. You know, I mean, I have never heard anyone go onto an organic garden growing vegetables and say, oh, my God, this is a disgrace. Get me out of here. I haven't heard that once yet.
Right. Right. You feel the energy when you're in places like that. It just feels good to be around that. All these efforts and the community, the micro community and the macro community that are all supporting life.
And then also, you know, when you get to the point of becoming intimate with those little goobers that inhabit the earth beneath your feet, then you can ask them for their assistance in your endeavor, and they do assist you in more ways than one. Because I know I'm in the bleachers, I don't have the box seat, so I just ask all those universal life forces to help me in my endeavor, and bingo, they're there. But if you don't ask them, they can't come.
Well, that makes a lot of sense to me, my friend. Absolutely.
I'm so glad. You have no idea how glad I am.
Well, you know, as someone who meditates and, you know, the spiritual unseen world is a very big part of my life, and I want it to be an even bigger part as I move on in years. So, to me, that makes a lot of sense. Intention, working with the environment around me, even communicating with it, talking to it, whatever. They've already proven there's so many studies already that show how talking to plants makes such a difference. I mean, you don't have to convince me.
And water, talking to water.
Yeah, water. Oh, my gosh. I talked to Evan a little bit about this. I saw a documentary on Gaia a few months ago. I think it was called The Secret of Water. I have a feeling it was a Russian documentary, and they overdubbed English words, you know, so you didn't have to read subtitles. But it was fascinating about all the things that water does, how it it's able to communicate, and it's able to remember things. And, you know, I came away from that with a completely different view of water, and, you know, it's part in our well-being and our ability and our ability to communicate. I think of the fact that we're, what, 70% water human beings? I mean,
80% water.
My goodness, if water has all these amazing attributes, then, you know, what happens to the water is what's happening to us. How the water is affected is how we are affected.
Most definitely. And because of biodynamics, I have an intimate relationship with water, and I have stirred many a 5-gallon pail. And during that stirring for an hour of the preparation, you're planting your intentions into that water. And I know, I feel it, that the water changes viscosity from the beginning of the hour to the end of the hour,
wow,
depending on how much I've pumped in there.
Fascinating.
That's my feeling. Yes, it is. It is. And it's very ensuring as well.
Yeah. Wow. Thank you so much, Linda. We're coming here to the end of our time. And I want to say how much, I know it's flown, hasn't it? I really so enjoyed this conversation. And, you know, honestly, you do have an open invitation. I'd love to have you come back again, maybe once the everything's going for you, and maybe you could share a little bit about what you're learning and the feedback you're getting back from the people that you're teaching and all. And we're definitely going to share all the information about how you can get compost in a box, or get to do the webinars that Linda is going to be producing. You'll see that when I post this this on our website. Is there anything that you'd like to add before we say goodbye to everybody, Linda?
Yeah, the only thing I would like to add is, please, go farm your yard.
Wonderful.
And by the end of the month, we will have our jingle will be recorded by a band. So you'll all get to hear our farm yard jingle. It's a movement, have you heard?
I've heard this. Thank you so much, Linda.
Thank you, Janice.
So appreciate having you on, and we'll see everybody next week. Bye-bye. Thanks for joining us on the Sustainable Living Podcast. For more sustainable living tips, join our Facebook group, Sustainable Living Tips, Tools, and Tactics, and follow us on Twitter.